be forced to do so.
Thanks, Senator Walsh.
Yes, pity.
Okay, Deputy Boyd Barrett.
Ambassador, I will say frankly, I'm one of the people who thinks you should be expelled from this country, and I believe that that's nothing to do with you personally, it's to do with the policies of your state. And I think, along with Desmond Tutu, that the time for treating you as a normal state is over, because you're not behaving as a normal state. And I just want to ask you questions, really, in relation to that contention. And I would just say, for the record, it certainly isn't motivated by anti-Semitism in my case. I mean, for example, when disgraceful attempts were being made to downplay the horrors of the Holocaust by people like David Irving, I brought a Jewish Auschwitz survivor to this city to organise meetings and get her on national television to remind the Irish people about the horrors of the Holocaust. And I would do so again if anybody tried to downplay the horrors of what were done to the Jewish people. But it is precisely because I'm opposed to racism that I oppose what your state is doing and what it stands for. So I just want to ask you a few questions in relation to that. And I should also say, by the way, I lived for a year on Moshav Neot Hakikar in the Dead Sea in 1987, 2 weeks before the First Intifada broke out. That leads me to my first question. You have tried to cover over what you have done, the killings of innocent people in Gaza on three separate occasions over recent years, the seizure of Palestinian land and so on, by attacking Hamas. Now, why don't you just admit that Hamas didn't exist when the First Intifada took place? They didn't set up an armed wing until the early 1990s. And that there was a reason that PLO were in Tunis at the time, exiled, effectively not present. But the ordinary Palestinians rose up because you denied them basic rights. I lived there. It was apartheid. It was racism. It was endemic. It was rotten. Absolutely, I was shocked within weeks of living there to see how you treated Palestinian people. And isn't it the fact that the law of return, which is the basic law of the Israeli state, is a racist apartheid law because it confers rights on Jews that it denies to Palestinians? It allows, for example, if I was Jewish and had never stepped foot in Israel, I could claim citizenship there tomorrow, but 6 million people whose origins are in what you now call Israel, who were forced out in 1947 or 48, do not have that right. Isn't that part of the reason why the Palestinians are in dispute with Israelis? Because you deny them the right to return to their homes and to their land and to their villages, and that they have a legitimate claim, even under international law, to return, but you deny them that right. Why do you deny them that right? And why do you give that right to other people who have no connection whatsoever with the land, whether you call it Israel or whether you call it Palestine? Why do you continue to seize land, if you're serious about Oslo and the two-state solution, why do you continue to seize land, which under that agreement is land designated to be Palestinian land? 500,000 people, most of which has taken place since Oslo, you allow that to happen. Why do you allow it to happen if you're serious about giving this land to the Palestinians? It's absolutely extraordinary. And it just, are you not just taking us, Ambassador, for idiots? That you can say with a straight face, we're serious about peace, but while we're serious about peace, we're going to seize Palestinian land. And you expect the Palestinians to just sit back and do nothing about that. And the world to accept that that is an acceptable way to behave. And you asked earlier on, what could we have some constructive solutions? Now, you know what the Palestinian people have been asking for. Far less even than some people would ask for. Because I believe the whole apartheid system should be dismantled. But what they've asked for is to lift the siege of Gaza. Just to lift the siege of Gaza. Let them have an airport. Let them have ports. Let them not be dictated to by a government for whom they do not vote as to what can go in and out of their territories, whether they will have power, whether they will have clean water, whether they will have medicine. What makes you think you're allowed to have nuclear weapons and the fourth biggest army in the world and visit destruction on the people of Gaza
But they have no right to defend themselves. They have no territorial sovereignty over that land.
Would you ask questions, please?
How do you justify that?
Yeah. All right.
How do you justify those double standards? And very lastly, Ambassador, people like Bishop Tutu, Nelson Mandela, and I would certainly describe your state as an apartheid state, with different laws for people depending on their race or religion. Now, isn't that just the case? That, for example, at checkpoints going into the West Bank, there's a channel if you're Israeli or European, and there's a channel if you're Arab. Just because you're Arab. If you came into Dáil Éireann and they stopped you and said, "Are you Jewish?" "Oh no, sir, you can't come in through the same entrance as Irish people or European people because you're Jewish," you would call that racism and apartheid. But yes, you practice that. You practice that with your checkpoints and your military barriers and your apartheid wall. How can you justify that?
All right, thank you.
Mr. Boyd Barrett, I think that I haven't heard so many clichés in such a short time, for a long, long time. You belong to those who think that I had to be expelled from this country. I'm sorry to delude you too. And the fact that you mentioned a few times already this afternoon that you are not anti-Semite raises questions. I'm not saying that you are.
Disgraceful comment.
I'm not saying that you are.
Absolutely disgraceful comment.
Please. But the fact that you mentioned it, I never claimed that you're an anti-Semite. The fact that you mentioned it.
Your document did.
Now, you said that you experienced, you lived in the Ota Kikar. It was very hot and dry there. I know the area very well. And you saw that Israel is a racist country. I know what you've seen. You've seen all these buses in which only Jews, Ashkenazi Jews, can enter, because the buses for Ethiopians, Russians, and Mizrahi Jews is a different bus. You probably saw the supermarkets to which only Israelis can enter. Arabs are not allowed. Or you haven't seen that, because these things do not exist in Israel. You know damn well that Israel is not a racist country. Israel is a country in which everyone has the same rights. Every person doesn't matter to which religion or which orientation he has the right
to vote and be elected.
We have in Israel politicians that represent the minority, the Arab minority. We have judges at different levels of the juridical system. We have army officers. There are a lot. We have diplomats who are either Druze or Bedouins or other kinds of Arabs. And we are very proud of that, because Israel is a democracy that respects the rights of everyone. I know you can say that you don't believe me, but
I saw it for myself.
If you've been, exactly, so you've seen different things.
Okay, please, I don't want this getting personal.
Now, if you, there are people, and I think you hinted towards that Israel was trying to mass murder the civilians of Gaza. In 2000, Gaza population was 1.2 million people. Today, there are over 1.7 million people. That means that we are doing a very bad job trying to commit genocide to these people. I think that Israel proved the opposite. Israel proved that it tries to avoid the loss of life of innocent people. The fact that this huge army of Israel did not cause more than, and I'm saying again, it's a terrible figure, hundreds of people died, but it could have been much, much worse than that if Israel wouldn't have been very careful when it was retaliating towards the Hamas. You speak about the right of return, which is another interesting phenomenon. What you're speaking about is the destruction of the state of Israel. That's exactly what you're talking about. Because giving the right of return to every Palestinian after... Wait a minute, I'm speaking.
Please... Deputy Barrett, Ambassador, could you stick to the point as quick as much as you can?
Yeah, I'm trying
to finish up the meeting.
It struck
you.
My mind very often.
Okay.
In 1948, 700,000 Palestinians, no, they were not Palestinians, sorry, they were called Arabs, because everybody that lived in Israel was a Palestinian, including Jews. until 1948. You may not know that, but that was the situation. So many, an amount of more than 700,000 Arabs left their homes, many of them because they were promised by Arab leaders and by the leadership of the Arab population there that if they escape, if they leave, they will come back after the Jews would be thrown to the sea. We all remember that. By the way, at more or less at the same time, 850,000 Jews were expelled, were forced to leave Arab countries, Iraq, Iran, Egypt, Yemen, Libya, and many, many more. So we, as if you're speaking about refugees, there were more refugees coming, or Jewish refugees, but the difference is huge. The Jewish refugees immediately became citizens of the State of Israel. They were well absorbed into the society, and now their children and grandchildren live as Israeli citizens. The Palestinians were never rehabilitated because it was the purpose of the Arab world to use them as a political tool. And this is why we do think that the organization UNRWA, that is in charge of Palestinian refugees, creates here a big problem, because during the from the 50s of the previous century, there were 50 million refugees around the world. All other refugees don't exist anymore. They were absorbed into different societies all around the world. Those that are still refugees, and not only those that left, I'm speaking about the children, grandchildren, and the children of the grandchildren, they all considered by you as refugees that have the right to go back to their homes. If that is the case, then my deputy has the right to go to her home in Poland, because this is where her family was expelled for. And there were millions of Israelis that would have the right. So that is not, this is not how it works. During the previous century, millions of people, tens of millions of people moved from one area to another as a result of different wars. So if you are speaking about the right of return, and by the way, this is a special innovation, right of return to a different country, if they would ask for a right of return to the future Palestinian state, it makes sense. But the right of return to a different country makes no sense to me.
Fox questions now, if you can.
Yeah, you also referred to different lines for Arabs. By the way, when I enter this country, I have to stand in line not with the EU passport holders, but with others. That's it, because this is the law. There were too many cases in which Arabs did try to blow themselves in airports, in ports, and in other places. So we take measures. It doesn't mean anything about their rights, and it doesn't show any kind.